Good morning.
Hello. We're back again.
Back again, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, we apologise if you might have had enough of seeing
our mission
faces,
is to,
but there we are.
Our we're mission back. Is to brighten your morning, but, you know, we're hoping that we're not going to darken it in any way. I'm not darkening it with my stubble.
Did you know he hasn't shaved since Springwatch? He shaved just for this broadcast.
Just for this broadcast this morning.
You were getting a bit furry.
And furthermore, I was so satisfied with my shave that I took a photograph. I know we're starting with personal hygiene, but I took a photograph of the sink with the with my shaving remains.
Nobody needs to see that.
Well, it's very satisfying. I can't be the only bloke that likes to look at a sink through, you know, excised, you know, hair there. It's a bit like when you've got one of those, you know, vacuum cleaners with a sort of a translucent bowl.
Right.
And when you've been, you know, vacuuming away, and then you look inside it and it's full up. It's so satisfying. There's nothing more satisfying, I think, if you're a bloke with, you know, and you haven't been shaving, and then you look into the sink and you see that. Look at that.
This looks gross, Chris.
Oh, look at that. Yeah.
You know, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. Nobody wants to see your shaven hair stubble.
No one wants to see the massive hole in the side of my hair either. Because yesterday, you gave me my second haircut.
Yeah.
Not as good as the first one.
No, but to be fair, it was raining and we were in a bit of a rush. You know, I felt I had to get it done quick, and I was just, it caught me off guard a bit. And I just...
Look at it. It's nice.
It's not that bad. Yeah. Although there is one really long hair here that's been bugging me. Yeah,
bugging me.
Get scissors out.
Anyway, welcome back to the Self-Isolating Bird Club broadcast. What a way to start with those goshawks, Latvian Fun for Nature, of course. We were watching those earlier in the year. Beautiful birds, stunning nest there, stunning nest. And we've been keeping our eye on that for some time. We've got a little clip now which shows you the history of this. It starts with the bird completely covered in snow.
It's amazing. You almost don't see that it's there.
I know. It sort of stands up and the snow comes off. I mean, what a remarkably robust bird that is to be incubating the eggs, as it was at that time, underneath all of that snow. And then at a certain point, you can see the eggs begin to hatch. There were four there. Look, four. That's a good clutch size, isn't it?
Yeah.
And look
how tiny they are.
There they are.
Little fluff balls.
These Latvian Fun for Nature cameras, if you haven't been watching, are well worth a look. There's a series of them. White-tailed eagle, goshawk, some owl species. They're really, really good. Look at the size difference between the female and the male here. That's sexual dimorphism for you, isn't it? Look at that. The male's diminutive.
Tiny.
Wow. Amazing. And then look, here they are in their second coat of down. Only two of the young hatched. Two eggs left in the nest, which subsequently disappeared. And then, look, they were rung, and the female is unusually aggressive. You watch this clip whilst the ringer is attending the youngster there. She's swooping in and screaming. I've only ever been at one goshawk ringing, and the female disappeared into the woods, was never seen again. Well, we could hear her chirping. Obviously, the whole exercise was...
Well, she came back.
Yeah, well, she was there.
She came back to the young,
but we didn't see her. She left the side of the nest, disappeared into the woods about 100 metres away, chirped for a while, but left everyone alone. We got through the exercise super quick.
But they did say from Latvia, those particular goshawks do tend to go for people's heads a little bit more.
Well, they've been attacking people.
In the
area. So I think the Latvian Fund for Nature have had them in sticking up for goshawks. Anyway, we're going to have to stick up for goshawks in a minute. Should we take a look at the Poole Harbour ospreys now?
Next.
We can go live to that nest down in Poole Harbour. Remember, this is a part of a reintroduction programme organised by Birds of Poole Harbour and Roy Dennis at Wildlife Foundation. Put a nest up, and earlier in the year, we were watching CJ7, weren't we?
We were. We all had our fingers crossed for her. She was part of the breeding programme, so she was translocated down here. And the hope was that we would, at some point in the future, have our first osprey chicks in 200 years in the south of England.
Well, we had an egg. In the end.
Well, yes. We were all waiting for a male to return. Now, unfortunately, that didn't happen. And we think, you know, we've heard reports that a lot of adults have not returned this year, and that's likely due to weather conditions. There's been really strong northeasterly winds, so it's been really difficult for them to get back, and we believe that there might have been quite a few mortalities, unfortunately. So perhaps our male that we were all hoping out for didn't quite make it. But our female did lay one egg. Of course, that egg was unfertilized. We were all watching.
Oh, she laid three in the end.
She did. She laid one, and then she laid a few more.
Okay.
Yes, I was doing the story chronologically.
Okay.
I was going chronologically, but you just ruined the punchline.
Oh, no.
Oh, honestly.
I went straight to the last page.
What do you like?
I went straight to the last page.
I can't take you anywhere. Right. But yeah, of course, she laid three eggs. They were unfertilized. We did see some behavior that she was trying to kind of incubate them for a little bit, but she didn't take as much interest as she would have done if they were fertilized. So is it a success? Is it, you know, something that we should be obsessed about? Of course it's disappointing, of course, but it's a real, it's really, really good because it is the first egg that's been laid, and it shows that our female CJ7 is ready to breed. She just needs a male to turn up, which hopefully will happen next
year. Another female's turned up. There's been that PT0, 2-year-old from Lock of the Low, has turned up.
Which I think you could see on that clip there.
Yeah,
she showed up.
I mean, the thing is, with those platforms and ospreys in place, they are a magnet for other migrating ospreys. And the hope is, as you say, that during migration this autumn, a male happens to swing by Poole Harbour.
Yeah. Take a little look.
I mean, who wouldn't?
Yeah.
You know, I'm always swinging by Poole Harbour myself. and then they, you know, forge a sort of relationship, and then the male comes back in the spring. But it is only a matter of time. And again, you know, we've had some tremendous successes this year when it comes to reintroductions. White storks, of course.
White storks.
Amazing, amazing story.
Yeah.
But I'm sure that Birds of Poole Harbour, Roy Dennis Wildlife Foundation, work will come to fruition pretty soon, hopefully next spring. Anyway, the thing is, that osprey nest hasn't been redundant. There have been a number of other visitors, some of them quite exciting. Have a look at this, because at night, it's been used as a platform for a churring nightjar. What about that? I'd say that was a fair switch.
I'd say that's pretty good. You can see it perched there perfectly. This is a male.
I know.
And here, then off you go. I love the way that he just takes off there. He kind of goes up and is just pushed back by the
wing. Look, now it lands on the camera. Listen, you can hear it churring. It's actually set up on top of the camera.
Mm. Yeah, and this is normally happening between about 10 p.m. and 11 p.m. So it's still a really good idea to watch this camera, particularly at that time, because you get to see a nightjar.
Yeah.
A nightjar.
Not only nightjars, there's also, look, on the right-hand side there, the two glowing beady eyes of a tawny owl, which has come to investigate.
You have to look really carefully, quite camouflaged, but you can see, oh, there we are, popped his head up. There we go.
Superb.
Look at that.
Superb.
Look at that. Not just for ospreys, this cam, you've got all sorts of wildlife coming in.
And there've been stonechats and other things during the daytime.
Yeah, a lot of birds do nest in osprey nests, don't they themselves?
Yes, they do. They do.
Yeah, because they're so big. So smaller birds will nest in below the actual osprey nest themselves. You have nests.
No threat
nests
to an osprey. Fish eating.
No.
Fish eating. Yeah. Anyway, look. Whilst we're on goshawks and ospreys, brace yourself. Brace yourself, because this is an extraordinary piece of footage which has come from Latvia. Here is an osprey's nest. Another one of the nests that they were watching, and it's basically it's being predated by a goshawk. So here's the osprey on the nest.
Mm.
Two eggs there, currently unhatched. Off she goes.
You see that chick there?
And look, watch this. Oh my goodness.
Oh, so swift.
So swift. We can watch it again and slow that down. But look.
Comes.
Look. Oh my goodness.
Just like that.
That is the goshawk.
That is predation at its finest, isn't it? That is something quite remarkable.
Well, that's what I call avian terminators. That's why I call them avian terminators. And if you look online, there is further osprey footage which you might find, I think, again on a Finnish site, where an osprey came to a nest of, well, I don't know, almost fully fledged, you know, a goshawk came to a nest of almost fully fledged ospreys and emptied the nest. I mean, they were as big, if not bigger, than the goshawk itself. It's a gruesome sequence, but it effectively farms them. It takes one, goes away, comes back, takes another one, takes another one, takes another one. And there are some almighty struggles on the nest, as the young are much larger than that one. Goshawks are formidable predators. Absolutely astonishing. And what about today's quiz?
Today's quiz, we have a quiz for you again. So of course, you know, we love a quiz. We've been doing it since we started. And today we're going to ask you, what call is this? Who does this call belong to? So have a listen.
Very characteristic. Very characteristic. Yeah.
There we are. There we go. So if you think you know the answer to the quiz, whose call was that, then please post that in the comments and we will get back to it at the end of our broadcast.
Earlier in the year, we were talking about a competition which had been inaugurated by Lucy McRobert and run in conjunction with BBC Wildlife magazine. Nature on Your Doorstep was a writing competition for young people. I'm very pleased to say they had 200 entrants, maybe
220 entrants.
And basically, they have decided the winners. An esteemed panel of judges have come up with the potential winners. And we are going to hear from one of them now. And this is the young lady who's 14 from Essex, Danielle Amazu. I'm getting too hot. Let's have a couple. Danielle Amazu Aku, who was winner of the 13 to 17 year old category, reading her very poignant story, actually. It's a brilliant piece of observation.
It's lovely.
Extraordinarily well written. So here's Danielle to read her winning story from Nature on Your Doorstep.
Hi, my name is Danielle. I'm 14 years old and I'm from Essex. My nature story is called The Homecoming. The lovely nightingale was flying home this year, and yet he didn't see as many planes as usual. No one was around. The towns and cities, and even countries that he saw, were covered by a blanket of deathly silence. And he wondered, had humans really stopped? They didn't usually go home, didn't migrate, nor stop doing. Although some called them human beings, in his experience, they rarely had time to be. As he went further northwards, closer and closer to home, the same thing was true everywhere. He didn't see the random acts of kindness or people grappling with video calls. He was too high in the sky. What he saw was the clean air and the other animals running free in cities. He saw the empty motorways and the empty streets and the empty shops. Not a soul was bothering the trees, no one cutting them down to build on top of them. He saw a few people in uniforms, an army uniform, he thought. But that was the only army he saw. Normally, there would be a war somewhere, and yet the only army he saw was peaceful. He came closer and closer to home, thinking all the while, until he saw his family and flew to join them, warbling a happy tune. And all his other cares flew away on the breeze, and the song of the nightingales forced out the earlier, eerie silence. Dawn came the next day, and the sun rose higher and higher, like a monarch nearing the peak of her career. And through the day, the sun reigned in her beautiful crown, with her rays making jewels of all they met. The fledglings, her loyal subjects, played in their playground beneath her benevolent gaze. Round and round the fallen fence, carefree and happy, and there was no one there to scare them away. And the nightingale looked at them, and then looked at the large nests of the humans. He saw the sadness of the humans and the happiness of the fledglings, and saw that they were in direct contrast. The fledglings used to be wary and kept close to the nest, and now it was the humans' turn. And yet, even he, the most far-sighted of nightingales, did not see the turmoil inside the hearts of so many innocent humans. And even if he had, he might not have understood why. He thought the humans should be happy to step off the treadmill they called life. The free and happy nightingale was blissfully ignorant of all those who had the opposite of his rest. All those people who were very sad inside those nests that were so big yet hadn't protected their heart from loss. Outside, the bird felt secure, singing without danger, deep into dusk. The bird was at home. While idly perching on a branch, he thought to himself, isn't it funny that when the humans are at home, the birds are at their safest? Thank you.
Very good.
Brilliant work, Danielle. That was brilliant. Beautiful piece, really well written.
I like the transposition of seeing it through the bird's eyes, looking at us and what's happened to us this spring, and the impact that that's had on the natural world.
Yeah.
And the conclusion that the birds are better off when we're all locked up is
poignant.
Quite telling.
Yeah.
Quite telling. But top work, Danielle. That's really, really, really good. We've got the other couple of winning stories from the other age categories coming up. We're going to read those.
Yeah.
A bit later on in a minute, but before that,
well, we're going to go to one of our favorite nests. Now, throughout the course of Self Isolating Bird Club, of course, we visited lots of different countries with lots of different nests, but there was one, wasn't there, that we kind of kept coming back to. It was one of our favorites, and of course that is the Wakefield peregrines. Now, we saw these, we can go live to them now. Let's have a look if they are there. No, see any action going on. Can't see any action. But we were following them very, very closely, right from the stage where she laid the four eggs, I believe, wasn't it?
Yep.
Three of those hatched, and we weren't quite sure. We thought one might be a bit of a dud egg, but then it surprised us all, one hatched too. So let's have a look at a bit of an update on how they're doing. We can go through the stages and see how they progress. So here we are. Here's the female incubating. It's often the female that incubates those eggs the majority of the time, and the male goes to provide for food for them, and you can see I know the little head peeping out the
wing
there.
Male feeding.
Yeah, so she builds up confidence in the male, allows him to do more and more duties, because eventually she will hand over, you know, more of the incubation and feeding towards him. But look how delicate they're being for such ferocious predators. You know, they are remarkable there. And you can see
one of the youngsters.
Yeah, you see how much they've grown.
Look at that. All four of them still going.
All four, I believe, are still going really strong. You know, they've grown really, really quickly. Look at that. They are gorgeous birds. You know, this adult pair have managed to hatch and raise 21 young in the last 6 years, which is an amazing feat. You know, they've done incredibly well. And, you know, they'll fledge about 35 to 42 days after they've hatched. So, you know, they're ready to go. What they'll do is they'll be running along the walls, they'll be wing flapping like you can see there, of course, stretching their muscles, preparing themselves for when they're confident enough to take their first flight. And they will stay within the Wakefield area, be provisioned by those adults for a couple of months, and they'll start slowly expanding their range, flying further and further afield to make territories of their own.
Yeah. Although we've been watching those peregrines, and there's been quite a lot of sort of extraordinary goings on, because we've been able to satellite track these birds and watch them more closely using these cameras. We've learned a lot more in recent years about the behaviour around the nest. And sometimes, you know, we've had females mating with their own offspring, the males that refuse to go, males killing males. It's a soap very often.
Yeah.
But talking of soap, we thought about introducing a new little, you know, which we say
segment.
strand into our broadcast, and we're going to call it Soapbox because we're not going to get on it in the sense that we're going to procrastinate something, but we're going to discuss something that's in the news that's vexing or concerning lots of people for you to think about yourselves. And today we thought we'd start with, wait for it, because there's been quite a lot of things aggravating people who care about the environment recently, but none more so perhaps than disposable barbecues. Lots on social media, lots of action being taken because up until relatively recently, when it started to rain, we had an extraordinarily dry spring. May, I think, broke all records for lack of rain in some places. And as a consequence of that, tinder dry countryside was at threat. And as lockdown came to an end, many people were venturing out, taking the disposable barbecues with them. And I'm afraid there were some tragedies.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's really difficult, isn't it? Because, of course, as lockdown eases up, people are I'm so excited to see family. I know, you know, we're excited to go and see people that we care about. Everyone's the same, you know, taking precautions to do it as safely as possible. And one of the things you can do, of course, is meet outside. And lots of people have been drawn to, you know, really beautiful areas, national parks. And, you know, it's nice, isn't it, to sit down, have some food and have a drink with the people that you care about, that you've missed a lot. But disposable barbecues, are they the way to go? Well, they have massive amounts of environmental impact. In fact, from Sainsbury's, they sold 300,000 disposable barbecues last year, which was over double the amount of previous years. And it's thought in the UK alone that we purchase over 1 million of these disposable barbecues. And I know there's been a lot of work going out with the fire service, having to go and extinguish these, you know, these.
But before we get onto that, what about the fact that these barbecues, a lot of the charcoal in them comes from tropical forests?
Lots of places in Africa.
They're not exactly, you know, environmentally friendly. They cost somewhere between £1 and £2.75, I was looking last night. Or I think you can spend, for a double size one, you can spend a fiver. But they're very cheap. But what's the environmental cost, firstly? Mm. Because all of that charcoal in there is coming from tropical forest overseas, which isn't good for that area. The second thing is the word disposable. I mean, you know, the idea, they're part of that throwaway culture. You've got obviously the charcoal, which is being burned, and then you've got the tin or the aluminium, which is there, which if it isn't properly recycled,
it can't be recycled. You know, it's a real problem. A lot of recycling firms have come out and said that they simply can't recycle them. So all of them do end up in landfill. It's a single use type of waste. And we know, you know, we want to really reduce that because we don't have the space for it, or, you know, and fire risk is just unbelievable.
People have got together to try and stop the sale of disposable barbecues. I was reading last night on the Scarborough News website, a campaign group to set up the sale to stop the sale of disposable barbecues has seen its approaches to major supermarkets change rebuffed. 2,500 members have already joined the Leave the Barbecue at Home pressure group since it was launched by Peak District resident Tony McCartney earlier this month. And there were significant fires, Codbeck near North Allerton, Digley near Holmfirth, which were caused by single-use barbecues during the lockdown. Mm. And of course, fire crews have complained, as you say, Meg, of having to go out and deal with lots more of these.
What you're seeing there is the fire which was in Wareham Forest, caused by disposable barbecues. So it does have a massive, massive impact. And I don't, you know, I like barbecue. I love a barbecue. A veggie barbecue. I'm vegetarian. You know, but if you're going to barbecue, do it responsibly, do it safely. You know, if you're able to do it in your own home, even better.
Look at this. Wildfires in the UK are becoming more frequent. 2018 and 2019 together saw more damage caused by wildfires than the entirety of the previous decade, with nearly 50,000 hectares destroyed in over 200 wildfires. Among these was a huge blaze on Marsden Moor, West Yorkshire, in April 2019 that burned 700 hectares. That's 1,730 acres of wildlife habitat. And it says here that the National Farmers Union has called upon authorities to start issuing public space protection orders to combat the increasing frequency of wildfires. National Trust are also involved with appeals that they're putting out, asking people to behave more responsibly with these things. And then I looked through and I found a couple of petitions which had been launched to ban these. There's one here. This is on change.org, and it was set up by, let's have a look, Kate Collinson, who actually lives down here in the New Forest. So far, 8,634 people have signed her petition. One of the sort of slight problems at the moment is that there are more than one petition. So unfortunately, people's signatures are being diluted a little bit. That's a bit of a problem. But, you know, she says here, I live in the New Forest. We've had several fires locally in the last few days caused by disposable barbecues, including the huge fire in Wareham, the one that we've been looking at, that took several days, 150 firefighters risking their lives, we might add, to put it out. And it's been said that it will take decades for the 200 football pitch sized area that's been destroyed to recover. So disposable barbecues. Oh, and then I looked for responsible use of disposable barbecues, and that was slightly more difficult to find. There was a lot of practical advice how to get the best out of them, i.e. how to get them to work properly, but eventually on some fire and rescue service sites I did see some advice on how to use them. The most important thing was taking enough water with you to fully extinguish them once you'd finished.
Yeah.
And when you think about it, if you are going to use one, all you need is a big tub of water to pour over it, because they're too hot to pick up, obviously, once you've finished using them. And that would solve the problem. Or maybe just don't use a disposable barbecue at all. Something worth thinking about, particularly if you are planning picnics, mm-hmm. like Meg says, with your loved ones. So a social distancing outside during the easing of this lockdown. But do think about the environmental impacts. Potential there. It's pretty serious. Anyway, should we head over to Lucy Chapman?
Lindsey.
Sorry.
Who's Lucy?
I don't know. I've shaved and
it's affected my
neurological, capabilities.
Lindsey Chapman.
I didn't realise that my brain was connected to my beard.
Neither did I until right now.
Well, I think quite a lot of blokes, have been relatively bright, have been bearded.
Yeah, well,
Bertrand Russell, he had a beard. Einstein had a moustache.
Yeah,
I'm going to jump into the beer chat quickly before it gets out of hand, because Andrew says that he has got facial topiary going on and maybe it needs a bit of a trim as well. So,
Andrew can send us pictures of his sink once he's done the business.
Oh, no.
Yeah, there is a bit of a call for a museum of hair as well, but I don't think we need it, people. I don't think that we need it this morning. But yeah, clearly affecting your brain. Not a problem. Good morning, everybody. It's lovely to be back from the north, from glorious Manchester. Loads of you saying hello and morning. Morning is the word of the day, talking to each other. Graham Stevens on the live stream says, here we go. And there's people all over the place. There's Gosport, the Isle of Wight, Worcester, Johannesburg, Northumberland, Scotland, Guernsey, South Wales, just to mention a few. Big morning to you all. It's lovely to be back. Hello in particular to Tamsin Wood's mum, Margaret, who is just so pleased to see your faces again. And to Becky Shaw, get this, Chris and Megs. She says, my four-year-old ran up and hugged the screen when you both appeared. So,
we give you virtual hugs back.
Virtual hugs. And to Helen Cherry this morning, who's captured hedgehogs on her camera. So she bought a camera for her garden. She hadn't seen any hedgehogs in her garden since 2009. Last couple of days, she's seen them on the camera. So good news. But hey, the big story of the morning is not that you guys are back, but that we can in fact see Sid and Nancy just behind you throughout the broadcast, and they are totally upstaging you. So hey,
they always do.
They always do. Apparently, they're digging a hole as well, so you might be able to get through to Australia by the end of this broadcast.
Where are they?
But obviously, we've been away from self-isolating bird club for a little while. Something tiny called Spring Watch was going on, apparently. But it is wonderful to be back. Obviously, the Facebook group has been going in the meantime, and it's just astounding what's been happening there. Obviously, I've been keeping up with what's been happening, your photos, your videos, arts, crafts, stories, literature, it is all there, which is just brilliant to see. And I wanted to show you some of it this morning, just to sort of give you a flavour of what's been happening. So let's start with this picture from Anne Marlowe. Now, she has built a really stunning pond, it has to be said. So she's taken some of the tips that you put out there back a few weeks ago, and she's built a wildlife pond. It's got a little bird bath at one end, so wildlife can get in and out if it needs to. But look at that. I mean, that's gorgeous.
Yeah, it's an amazing pond, isn't it? The different levels there, and as time goes on, that's going to really start to fill up with lots more.
That's a top pond, actually.
It's really good. Yeah. It's a really good pond.
I'm going to give that pond...
Oh, no.
I'm going to give it a pretty high for me. I'm giving it a 6.2.
Oh, that's good.
6.2. Okay, well, just keep that score in mind, because let's look at Cash's pond now. This is in a washing up bowl and it's got visitors. So I didn't know we were going to rate everybody's ponds. I love that we are.
What's in there? I can't quite see on the small screen.
Tadpoles.
Oh, tadpoles.
There we go.
Worth a point on its own. That one, I'm going to go to 7.1 on that.
7.1?
With tadpoles. Oh, tadpoles are an endless source of joy.
It's true.
I'm sure the live stream's going to have something to say about the rating system, because, what are you judging it on? What are you judging it on? let's have a look at this, though. This is one of my favourite things that I spotted on the Facebook page, and Kate and Fabian saw it as well. This is the self-isolating bird club bingo card. It's just a joyous thing. This is from Simon Wood, and basically you can play, you know, like any bingo game, but some just wonderful suggestions. The row about giving ducks bread, of course, you know, stick away from that one. Fake photo accusation. We don't want any of that. just, you know, brilliant, funny comments to keep the spirit of...
Is there a poodle spotting on there? There should be Sid and Nancy spotted, you know.
Yes. So and questionable hairstyle as well. But it is wonderful. I hope you're playing now at home, Simon Wood. You better be playing now. Let's show you a little bit of footage, though, because there's loads of videos that ping up as well. Now, producer Kate, she's actually captured this bit of footage. And this is a canal in Hampshire where she lives. And what's brilliant about this, it's gorgeous. But look at the clear bottom of that canal. She says she's never seen that because obviously people are out on the water. But in lockdown, they haven't been as much. So the silt hasn't come up from the bottom. It's just a gorgeous picture. And what really impressed her was the sort of the power of these birds. So the swan family there, she saw the cygnets, but also the beating of the wings on the water. I mean, it is something to behold with you know, natural nature that's quite familiar to us.
It is indeed, yeah. Swans, I mean, people love swans. They're easy to access. There's plenty of them. They've got a whole distributed all over the UK. Parts of the extreme north are absent, but they're a very characterful species. People, and they're long lived, and as a consequence of that, people form bonds with them on a sort of a year by year basis. They look forward to them coming back, monitor their breeding. But the clean water. It's one of those things, again, isn't it? Do we want to go back to the way that it was, or do we want to moderate some of our behaviour so we make more space for a healthier environment? It's a discussion that's got to happen.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what we're beginning to think about, isn't it? Going forward as we begin to move out of lockdown, how we keep those connections, because everybody has been talking about nature and wildlife. And someone on the page, actually, that's been really engaged and really brilliant is Marion Veal and her fox, Vix. Now, I know both of you have seen this. In fact, Vix featured on the promo for this show. But this has a story behind it. So Marion noticed Vix, first of all, on her night camera and then in the daytime as well. Now, when she first noticed Vix, Vix wasn't very well. And it looked like she was exhausted, she was scruffy, and she might have had mange. And in fact, she did. Now, South Essex Wildlife Hospital did help Marion. They sent some treatment, and Marion was leaving food out on her garden, on her patio as well. But the progress of that fox, and I know you've both been seeing these clips, is really impressive, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. Fantastic. A lot of people do medicate their animals. It's quite tricky because you've got to make sure the medication gets to the right animal. But here, with just one fox visiting, Marion was able to do that. And it works over a period of time. It takes a few months to get rid of that sarcoptic mange, but you can get rid of it. But again, that close association that people have with animals is incredibly reaffirming. And
they're barking at the sheep.
They're barking at Captain Tom, probably.
The sheep's just sitting there like, what is it?
We've loved that. Marion's Vix as well, messing around with eggs as well, which is great that she leaves out for it, which is fantastic.
She's a beautiful fox, isn't she? Those ears, they're so poignant. They're great.
And I think the development as well of that animal over the last few weeks is just wonderful to see. Let's see some other brilliant things, though. Let's just keep exploring what you've been looking at with some fabulous photos. So starting with Mike Kirby, and this is a death's head Hawkmoor caterpillar. And I thought you'd like this because of the colours. Look at that.
Stunning, isn't it?
That's incredible.
It's like something out of Avatar.
Yeah.
I mean, you couldn't make it up, could you? The colours and the patterning on there are quite extraordinary.
A hawk moth caterpillar, beautiful. Then there was this shot. Now, I really like this. This is a cuckoo and a sedge warbler taken by Keith Bannister. But I just enjoyed, you can sort of see the different personalities there of those two birds.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, sedge warbler giving it all its go. It's like, I'm small, but I'm still going to tell you off.
Well, the cuckoo's telling a sedge warbler off, I reckon, because it's probably, you know, been fostered into its nest and the cuckoo's demanding food. And you can see that bright orange gape of the cuckoo there, which is the signal for the sedge warbler to put food here. It does look like the warbler hasn't got any on this occasion. So, like you say, Megs, it's getting a good tearing off. Great bit of behaviour.
I like them a lot. It was a good. And then a couple of my favourites. This is why these stood out to me. Tim Thompson took this one at Slimbridge. This is an avocet, and it's sort of becoming an umbrella for its two chicks. How gorgeous is that?
Yeah, that's really great. That is really, really good. Yeah, really good.
And Paul Leach sent this picture in, and I picked this because I've actually found two curlew near me, so I've been going out to watch them, and I just thought, what a great picture.
I mean, the position of that bird is amazing. Look at how it's moved its neck.
Look at that.
That's quite amazing. It's like a waterfall of feathers, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, so he says, I give you Colin, the world's only flamenco dancing curlew, 7. And I thought that was pleasing. Caught my eye. But obviously, as you both know, there's nothing that I love more than a photo that maybe hasn't gone quite right. And Nev Walker sent this one in, and he says, I'm thinking of asking Chris Packham's opinion on my picture of a kingfisher. And I thought everyone would love to share this. You know, send me your thoughts. Yeah. It's so beautifully crafted, that shot.
Yeah, it is. It's magnificent. I mean, it would be all right if I had the Hubble Space Telescope to zoom in on the kingfisher, which is occupying 2.3 pixels on the frame there. I mean, the thing is, I suppose you've got to be asking what a photograph's for. Sometimes you're trying to perfect the art as a means of perfecting an art. Other times you're trying to capture a moment and they're to stimulate a memory. And I'll never forget that picture now.
I hope it's staying with you for all the wrong reasons.
it won't take me back to that moment where I saw a kingfisher across the sunlit water, because I can't see the kingfisher skimming across the sunlit water. But for the photographer, it will ignite that little memory and stimulate it. And so sometimes they don't have to be brilliant. They're just there as cues for us personally to trigger those memories. But it won't trigger mine in the right way.
What I particularly enjoyed about that picture is that not only is the kingfisher not in focus, but really neither is the water. Like, none of it is in focus. Excellent. And Marion, just to go back to Marion, she did put another wonderful post on talking about people's excellent photography, because it is brilliant on the page. But she wanted to see people that maybe, you know, just had their phone and tried to grab something and it didn't happen. And the stream just goes on and on. It's wildlife with no heads or no feet. It's amazing. So have a little look at that. Quick one to come back to you on. Bruce says the voting system for the ponds is worse than Eurovision. So we need to sort that out big time. But I'm going to finish with a few questions, and these come from some video footage. So the first one is from Be A Bit Wild, and it's to do with eating weird stuff. I've eaten some weird stuff during lockdown, whatever's in the cupboard. But this is a piece of footage of two foxes that she's been watching, and they are eating a hare. So obviously that's quite a big thing for a cub to get its chops around. But she sort of wonders whether the fox will have tracked and killed that hare, or whether the hare is quicker, so maybe it was dead already, and whether there's any sort of problem with how putrid something could go if it was just lying around for ages and a fox picked it up.
Yeah, all good ideas, good questions. I mean, hares are incredibly quick. So on a straight race, they'd outrun a fox, wouldn't be able to catch them. Mm-hmm. But the fox, of course, employs the element of surprise and tries to get as close to the rabbit or the hare as possible, so that basically it can catch it before it gets up to speed, effectively. I think instances of foxes catching hares would be relatively few and far between. But as you say, scavenging is a big part of their diet. So it's likely that it could have been roadkill or otherwise it could have died. And one of the interesting things about foxes, one of the things that makes them the most successful small carnivore in the world, red fox, in terms of their distribution and numbers and adaptability, is that they have the capacity to eat food which is very rotted and infected with things like botulism and salmonella, which would obviously significantly harm us. But their stomach enzymes and acids are sufficiently fortified that they can eat rotting things. And the reason for that is that they store food, like Marion's eggs that she puts out. You know, foxes, if they come across a source of food, will take some of it, bury it, cache it, and then go back to it. And they are able to eat it when it's rotting. So again, that makes them a successful animal. So it doesn't matter how rotted the hare was, the fox's cubs will still enjoy it.
That's absolutely incredible. Wow. Thank you very much for that. I found a tin in the back of my cupboard from 2007. Do you think that I can still eat that?
Yeah.
Be fine.
Tinned food. I mean, that's the whole purpose of tinned food. You shouldn't have started me on this.
No, it's...
Okay, I'm going to carry on. Another video, something eating something strange. This is sent in by Julie Sage. Now, have a really close look at this, because this is a hedgehog, but it's eating a bird. I have never seen that.
Yeah. I mean, it does happen, particularly because, of course, it's been incredibly dry, which means access to earthworms and other invertebrates might have been lower. So you do actually see hedgehogs eating birds, fledglings, and potentially eggs too. And there were studies done that looked at the stomach contents of hedgehogs. I think this was done in Norway, and they found that 30% of a population had evidence of gull chicks in their stomachs. Mm. So it is, you know, it is prominent. They will turn to chicks and other birds and eggs if they can get them, particularly when times are low of earthworms and things like that.
Yeah, we saw that one earlier, didn't we, where there was a hedgehog chasing a blackbird fledgling. Yes. and killing it when it was on the ground. So I mean, they are in members of insectivora. They are carnivorous. They don't just eat invertebrates. So hedgehogs, and as you say, that, you know, all those gulls, you've got to remember, cast your mind back a few years, where on the Western Isles of Scotland hedgehogs have been introduced, and they were doing quite a lot of damage to ground nesting waders there, and there was controversy because the hedgehogs were removed from those islands where they hadn't previously been living, and as a consequence the wader population bounced back after the hedgehogs were removed.
That's really interesting that you've said that, because someone's saying, Alexandra, in fact, says, do they predate them or is it opportunity? So actually, a bit of both,
but definite predation. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah,
very interesting indeed. Thank you very much. Lots of people saying a hedgehog eating a bird. Oh, but yes. Right. Final thing to leave you with. And it's been wonderful to see you all this morning. Thank you for joining us. Great to see your faces back on the Bird Club. If you're missing nature festivals, by the way, outdoor festivals at the moment, Manchester has a Festival of Nature, which they do every year, and I support that. And they've actually moved it online. So they're doing a virtual festival on the 28th of June. So I thought that might be interesting for all of you who are watching us online. But I'm going to leave you with one of our watchers. The dogs are back from overseas. Now, this is Evelyn Heath. And she lives just near Seattle in the US of A. And I know there's people all over the world watching. She's originally from Luton. And we love watching wildlife that you've got on our cameras here in Britain. But have a look at this cheeky little fellow, just checking that her camera is recording properly.
Oh, look at that. It's great, isn't it? Raccoon. Again, another great opportunistic omnivore, the raccoon. Really successful animals.
Really raccoon cam.
Superb stuff. Lindsay, thank you very much.
Yes. Pleasure. Lovely to see all the stuff. Keep chatting to each other. Catch you soon.
Thanks, Lindsay.
Thanks, Lindsay. I'm just sat here pulling cleaver seeds or goosegrass seeds out of Auntie's coat.
Very damp poodle.
Damp poodle, but full of goosegrass seeds, which isn't good for the grooming process, is it?
No, not at all.
One of the friends of Self Isolating Bird Club is Paul Goldstein. Paul Goldstein is a polymath, in the sense that he's good at a lot of different things, and he does a lot of different things. Mm. Let's concentrate on a couple of them. Firstly, his photography. He's a great photographer. And secondly, his fundraising capabilities. He's raised hundreds of thousands of pounds, particularly for charities that are related to looking after tigers in India. Mm. He's run any number of marathons.
Dressed
as a tiger.
Yeah, of course.
You know, in a 30-ton suit or something, he'll exaggerate. Yeah. But no, he's a great bloke. And he has a small pond near where he's been in lockdown in the south of London. And he's made a film about his, well, to be honest with you, it's the way that he's connected with the pond. Because I'm sure Paul would have known the pond was there, but he would never have spent as much time looking at the wildlife there, photographing that wildlife, and ultimately caring about that wildlife before lockdown. So here's Paul Goldstein's Tale of the Pond in South London.
It's funny how lockdown has forced us to rethink, to look at the world through wiser eyes. Generations used to jumping on planes and crossing continents are now forced to search for wonders in their own backyard. My name is Paul Goldstein. I'm a wildlife photographer and former frequent flyer. Welcome to Pond Life. This is the Three Kings Pond in Mitcham, South London. It's the kind of place we pass on our commute without noticing. But it's a tiny piece of wildlife habitat in the heart of the urban jungle and home to this family of swans. The male, or cob, is Reggie. He's an overprotective father who considers this nest site to be his exclusive territory. He's the king of Three Kings Pond, and no one moves in without his say-so. He's seen off ducks, herons, and geese. And I've even seen him take on a number 44 bus. Reggie is most definitely the daddy. We'll call the female swan, the pen, Florence. Locals tell me she had 5 cygnets last year, but sadly lost some of them. This year, she's raising 7. The first thing I do every morning when I find them is count to ensure they've made it safely through the night.
Urban photography. You've got to work with what you're given. And my dream shot here is to get the swans in the reflection of a red bus. Is it easy? No, of course it isn't. But it wouldn't be fun if it was easy. And most importantly, when you want a bus, there's never one there. It's going well then.
Geese.
Okay, again.
I was coming closer and closer to achieving that magical alignment of Cygnus Cygnus with double-decker bus. But I was distracted by all the rubbish. Had it always looked like this? I asked Derek Hambrook, whose house overlooked the pond.
I was born here back in 1936. The pond was clear, always clean and tidy. We could paddle in it and swim in it. We was all just one big happy family type of thing.
What annoys Derek most?
Mainly it's the litter. The people who come round the pond at the night time sitting there drinking and things like that, and they leave all the mess there.
As an inner city family, Reggie, Florence and the kids are used to living in this human mess. But they shouldn't have to be. Cleaning up the pond was going to be a long job, but suitably socially distanced help was on its way.
Morning. You're here. Well, well, well. Reinforcements. Should we clear this place up?
Yeah. Yeah.
Every day is a challenge for his family. Reggie continues to defend his turf against all comers. For 40 years, no swan nested here. And while this is no swan lake, it's no swan dive either. And with a pond don like Reggie running the manor, there's a good chance that his offspring will make it.
Reggie.
Hey.
Oi. Reggie. What a bird.
Oi.
What a swan.
What a swan.
What a swan.
Hey. That swan's running a racket around there. I think the plan was to continue clearing the pond.
Yeah.
I think continuing clearing the pond has actually been taking place. So there may be an update at some stage from Paul about,
I hope so.
You know, but that's just brilliant. And I bet you a pound, although I'm not a gambling man and I would never give you the pound, even if I lost.
You wouldn't.
I wouldn't. But I bet you that sort of thing's been happening all over the UK. Mm. People have gone out to their ponds and been picking up that litter and thinking, God, this is a beautiful spot, spoiled by that crisp packet. You know, and
that crisp packet.
There was a crisp packet in there. Yeah.
What were you about to say, Chris Packham?
No, there was a crisp packet.
Spoiled by that Chris Packham over there.
I've spoiled any
You're
number of
ponds. You're spoiling all the ponds.
I'm spoiling ponds all the
Stop
time.
Stop spoiling it.
Spoiling everything this morning. I should have slept last night. I wasn't. I was watching a sci-fi. I watched a sci-fi called Underwater.
Mm.
And then I started watching Flock of Seagulls videos from the 1980s.
Yeah, of course.
I was still doing that at 2 o'clock, which was proving
Actually,
to be a mistake.
Why wouldn't you?
I can barely get my words out this morning. Anyway,
But lots of people being proactive, and of course in their local environment is fantastic. And some people have been being very proactive, entering their writing into some competitions.
Yep.
So we're going to go through the winners of the last two categories for Lucy McRobert's competition,
Nature
on Your Doorstep.
On Your Doorstep. So this is the winner in the 7 to 12 category, and it was written by Anna Stone.
Yay, well done, Anna.
11 years old and comes from Norfolk. Yes. It's slightly dishevelled by the rain, but I'll do my best, Anna. It was a sunny day, perfect for hopscotch, skipping, and most importantly, gardening, which is exactly what Emily Swift was doing. She was down on her knees, digging and planting, digging and planting. Emily liked the repetition of it. If she was bored or unhappy, you would find her in the garden, listening to the birdsong and running her hands over the soft bark of the apple tree. It would tell her of every single apple it had grown, describing how each one had been carefully crafted, green and red, and how it had been specially picked, ready for jam or crumble. The tree itself was beautiful, blossoming at the moment, with big pink flowers, and soon it would be covered in green. The leaves swayed in the wind, just enough to make the goldfinches nesting in it wobble gently. Emily wandered over to it. "Good morning," she whispered. "I have some bad news." The evening before, Emily had been sat down at the table. Her parents had the faces on. They gave her the moving speech. They told her her father's job was important, it was the main income, and to keep it running, they had to move. There was only one option, and they were sorry, but the only thought in Emily's mind was she would have to leave the apple tree. Her apple tree. When she told the tree, it simply sighed and told her of an apple. The apple was small and green and quiet. Unlike its confident siblings, it hid itself away into the branches. When picking day rolled around, it didn't want to go, begging the apple tree to let it stay. The apple tree told it that if it did not leave, it would fall and rot. And if it did, it would be enjoyed. It told the apple that it was not holding it back. The apple stayed in the branches, and the tree, as it said, fell and rotted. You see, the tree quote, "If you refuse to leave, how will you blossom? You'll rot away if you stay here." So she made her way inside and climbed the stairs to bed. Emily Swift was gardening in this house for the last time, digging and planting, digging and planting. Beside her, the apple tree swayed. Emily, it croaked, "I have a gift for you." Emily wandered over and a knobbly branch came out. On it was a brown paper parcel. On the way to the new house, Emily opened the package. She smiled when a handful of brown apple seeds tumbled out. She did not have to leave the tree, she realised. In fact, she had it in her hands.
Beautiful.
What a great story. Love
that
the metaphor between the little green apple and Emily the young gardener, and that whole transposition about needing to move on to blossom, which sometimes, as Emily has pointed out, is absolutely true. We can't stay in the same place all the same time and not achieve new things.
And congratulations, Anna, that's really,
really
well deserved.
Really,
you've done some amazing
great
storytelling
story.
There.
Okay, well now done. The last that- one is stuck to the table. Oh, no, you've got your
I've
own.
Got it. I've got
okay,
it here.
You've got it. Okay.
So this last one is the winner of the 4 to 6 age category. And the winner is Benji James. So congratulations, Benji. I know Benji's been a fan of the SIBC. In fact, he made his mum get social media so that he could watch it. So we hope you are watching.
Thanks,
and
Benji.
I hope I do your story justice. So here we go. The first time I saw Flutter and Flims, they were still in their eggs. When they became chicks, I found out that they weren't just brought up by sparrows, but other garden birds too. Robins, blackbirds, blue tits, a great tit, doves, magpies, a crow, and a pigeon all helped to raise them. I next saw Flutter and Flims when I was on the wing, and a flock of sparrows flew over my head, and there they were. While the other sparrows kept to their places in the flock, Flutter and Flims were dancing about in the flock to welcome each other. On my 5th birthday, they came to see me again. and on my fifth Christmas, they came again and hopped outside the kitchen window to see me. When I was six, I found out how to talk to them, and I named them Flutter and Flims. It's beautiful, isn't it? That connection that we build, you know, when, with the wildlife that we can see, whether, you know, we see them as eggs, we see birds as eggs, and when they hatch and grow, and it's just lovely to see that kind of raw connection with something that comes to visit through the window. It's lovely. Beautifully written. Well done, Benji.
Benji, top work. Great story. Great idea, that competition. Thank you, Lucy, and to everyone else who ran that, BBC Wildlife Magazine. Great to get some creativity going. And those winning stories were really, really good. You know, if I was scoring them, I'd score them really high.
Yeah.
Really high, all of them. I'd be giving them like 9 points something.
That's impressive. Yeah, nobody ever gets 9 points.
No, but they all had their strengths. Firstly, the bird's view of the humans, and then that metaphor with the green apple, and then the last, as you say, the connection between those birds in a personal space, which is really, really good stuff. Okay, you do the music. You ready?
You ready? Okay. Dun it, dun it, dun it, dun it, dun it, dun.
That was pretty bad.
Sorry.
Jaws music. Dun it. Dun, 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 dun. Anyway, it's not a shark. We it's thought we would show you this, but we're running a bit short of time, so we're not going to go into it in any great detail. This is the jawbone, and so is this here, of a cetacean, a tooth cetacean.
Have a look.
Because you can see the little teeth there. Look.
This beauty.
Yeah, there we are. Look at that. Ooh. Yeah, it's nice, isn't it?
It's gorgeous, isn't it? This is something called a telescoped skull, because the upper jaw and the bottom jaw is elongated, which of course we see with our cetaceans, our whales, our dolphins and our porpoises. But this belongs to a dolphin, we believe. I tried looking yesterday, I was counting the number of teeth. Of course it's missing a few teeth, but the number of teeth that should be there. And I was trying to compare it to figure out what species this is, and it came to no luck. So if you are a dolphin expert out there, if you're able to ID this for us, we would greatly appreciate it.
What I like is this bit here though, because obviously the brain case is here, and then it's got this compressed area here, this concave region here. This is where the melon sits. So when you think about a dolphin or a porpoise, it's got, you know, it's got a domed round head like that, and that's because here you've got the melon. And the melon is an organ which focuses and collects the sound, well, focuses the sound to send it out. The sound comes back to the lower jaw in some species. So when it's, you know, echolocating in the water using its sonar, as it were, then it's sending the sound out. It's channeling that sound through the melon and receiving it back through its lower jaw. What an extraordinary piece, again, we've said before, animal architecture, but it's very, very beautiful. I'm not sure what species it is. Still got some skin on. A little bit of work needed there later.
Toothbrush out. Don't use mine, all right?
Toothbrush out. Okay, another friend of SIBC is Luke Massey. Luke Massey has a farm in Spain, which he's sort of putting back together with his family. And if you were watching earlier in the year, you will have seen him sending us reports of his dawn chorus that he did. He went out and he saw Jennet. Remember, he made us very envious. We got Jennet on his trap cameras. He also got Pine Martin. It's a very beautiful part of the world. But here he's reflecting on the return of his swifts.
When I lived in the UK, swifts were the sign that summer was there, you know. You didn't see them kind of drifting through and then suddenly they're screaming down your street and that's it. They're zipping about. They're a proper sound of my childhood. Where one of my best mates lived, he had loads of them on his street and you could sit out on the kind of flat roof outside his bedroom and they'd be zipping up and down the street and going into people's eaves. But here, because of where we're situated, they're a sign that summer is on its way, because I really need to write more things down. I have a nature diary, but I just forget to write in it. So I think it was early April that I heard my first swifts and spotted them hawking about really high up, and they were probably migrants heading further north. At the minute, we don't actually have swifts nesting on the farm. It is our plan to set up some boxes this winter, so hopefully we'll encourage a colony. And most of the time we do just see them hunting up high, but every now and again, if the weather conditions are right, they drop much lower. And the other day, we were out and about, and just suddenly we were surrounded by swifts and swallows, but mainly swifts. There must have been 100, 200 of them zipping about the farm at eye level, and because of the way we are, you could look down on top of them as well, and they're just so, so fast. The peregrine falcon cheats a little bit. You know, they reach 200 miles per hour in a straight stoop, dropping out the sky, so gravity's helping them a bit. But I think common swifts, they're actually the fastest flying bird in level flight. I think they've been recorded up to 69 miles per hour. And they really, really are fast, you know. And they just drop one wing and turn on a sixpence. It's incredible. My fingers are firmly crossed that some of these guys, or at least some of their offspring or relatives, return next year and check out our swift boxes so we can have our very own swift colony on the farm.
I've seen one or two.
Yeah, I saw a couple in the New Forest when I was out walking. I haven't seen many around here.
No, one or two I've seen.
Yeah.
Swallows have been over the field, which is uncut this year. So they've been out there hawking for insects. None here at the farm. Our hirundines are in trouble, aren't they? I mean, we're not in the best place for swifts, to be quite honest with you. And sometimes urban areas are better for them. But it's sad to see them. Anyway, if Luke gets his boxes up and then plays some, gets some speakers and plays the swift call, that greatly enhances the chances that you get take up in your swift boxes.
Yeah.
And designs for swift boxes are available online, or you can purchase them. And Swifts UK are a great group of people to follow if you want to find out more about swifts.
It's a great thing to do, of course. You know, we like putting up our conventional bird boxes, but why not think about putting up a swift box too? Particularly if you're building something new, you can actually build them into the hat. It's great.
Hey, what about this? Look, I've got a soggy pie chart.
But it's very soggy.
It's all going Damien Hirst, isn't it? Look, seriously.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
It's not up to your usual pie chart standards, Chris. I'm quite disappointed.
I didn't originate that pie chart. I'll show it to you briefly. Just to say that we are looking through all of your comments.
Yeah.
I've also got a spreadsheet with your comments. When we ask you what you thought we should be doing with SIBC in the future, then I couldn't print this one off, but Michelle Reed here says, I like wild space. How about wild nature? And then someone else is saying it would be really good to do. Vicky Brown, I'd love to see wildlife from other countries. Mm-hmm. So we could try and get in contact with plenty of people who are following us from overseas. That would be really good. So, well, we had the raccoon this morning, but a bit more of that would be good. Someone else is saying we should be doing more paleontology, effectively. How you could include stuff about extinct nature, like fossils. There's the whole host of things in here. We are working our way through them, and also a lively conversation about what we should do about the name too. So maybe we could report on that next week when we've had more time to go through this. I'm just looking here, there's loads, isn't there?
If you do have your own ideas about what you want Self-Isolating Bird Club to be, what you want it to evolve into, please do put comments, not just about the name change, but what content do you want to see? Do you want, you know, more worldwide focus on nature, more UK stuff? Would you like to see more young people? Perhaps you'd like to take it over yourself and do your own live streams that we can help facilitate, and you can show us what you've got going on in your garden. Perhaps we get more authors, or, you know, any ideas like that. We'd really love to hear that, and talking about live streams, or whether it's something, you know, a little bit different to a book club, perhaps. Do let us know.
I think the other thing is fundraising. Quite a few people are conscious of the fact that our wildlife NGOs have been struggling under the lockdown, and obviously they furloughed their staff. Now they're worried about people not being able to visit their sites where they generate income from their cafes and their shops and so on and so forth. People might be thinking about their membership as we're going forward. Obviously, there are threats of a significant recession. People will have less money to spend. But wildlife will still be in trouble. As a consequence of that, maybe we should use some aspect of Self-Isolating Bird Club to raise funds for certain NGOs which are needing them. So there is that all in mind, and we'll be thinking about that, no question about it. Okay.
Questions? Well, our quiz, I think. So earlier on at the beginning of the broadcast, I asked you to identify whose call this is. So let's see if we can listen to that again. Uh, There we go. Okay, that was the mystery call. And I can say that quite a few people got that one right. So Lottie, age 9 on Facebook. Well done, Lottie. We've got John, we've got Michelle, Jenny, Maya, Ashley, Belinda, Anise, Kate, Martin. Well done. Twitter, we've got Jill, Verity, Keith, Heather, Mike on YouTube. We've got Paula, James and Simon. No sign of Shane. I wanted to give Shane a quick shout out.
Well, he was going back to work.
He was going back to work. So Shane, if you do watching this on catch up at some point, we hope you're well. Do let us know how you're doing. Yeah. We miss your comments every day.
Top work.
So well done to everyone who got that one right.
Okay, what about birthdays?
Birthday? Well, we haven't revealed the answer yet.
Oh, sorry.
No.
Reveal the answer. It's lucky we're not working on Who Wants to Be a Millionaire or Mastermind, isn't it?
Can you imagine? What could we do awfully, wouldn't we?
No, not very good.
We're not.
It was a Kingfisher, wasn't it?
It was a Kingfisher. So well done to everyone who got that correct.
Sorry about that. Okay, what about birthdays? Any Kingfishers in the birthday?
There is a special birthday today that we can't forget. Chris's partner, Charlotte. It's her birthday today. She's over on the Isle of Wight. We want to wish Charlotte a very, very happy birthday. We hope she has a fantastic day with her giant rabbits and everything else and gets to do some nice stuff.
And this afternoon, she's going to be broadcasting from the Wild Heart Trust Sanctuary on the Isle of Wight, which is a rescue centre for big cats that have been abused in circuses. And I think that starts at 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Yeah, you might say hello.
I might say hello. Yeah. So try and catch that on Facebook this afternoon on the Wild Heart Trust site.
Yeah, and on your page.
And on my page.
Okay. But other birthdays too. So Deborah Williams, happy birthday to you. Dawn West, Leslie Hughes, and Fiona Newton is 60 today. So very, very happy birthday to you all. We hope you have a fantastic day. Hopefully it's not too drizzly where you are and a bit of sunshine does come out to say hello.
Yes, indeed. Look, the wind's blowing on our laptop about now. Just before we go, I ought to update you on... Mouseageddon.
No.
I can't tell you. This is what it's like. Look, here's a little clip of what it's like, okay, you know, at Shea Packham McCubbin. You know, it's not Shea Packham McCubbin, it's Shea Mouse. You know, there are mice running amok everywhere. You know, that is the problem. And, you know, we've done everything we can to discourage the mice from coming into the house. But last night I heard the patter of tiny feet.
You heard the patter. I heard the rumblings. I heard the thunder of tiny feet storming round the roof like some kind of, I don't know.
What's unusual, okay, whilst we're on Mouseageddon, what's unusual is that we've got yellow-necked mice and wood mice here in the same place at the same time. And I always thought that there was an intolerance between them, in that yellow-necked mice being larger and just like the hedgehogs, you know, they're quite predatory and quite carnivorous when they want to be. I would have thought that the yellow-necked mice would have driven out the wood mice and we'd only been dealing with one species, but they seem to be happy to cohabit. We've got both species here at the same time. So it's a privilege to have the yellow-necked mouse, of course. Chewing up your car, chewing up your trousers, chewing up your bags, chewing up your
life. Chewing up your life.
Chewing up my life.
They chew up your life.
Still, they're a really attractive animal. Maybe. So, I mean, it's like, we've just got, I don't know what we can do.
No, we just live with them. Just, you know, we're not living with lions, are we?
No.
We're not living, you know, with
big
predators.
I do come out here at night now and start hooting like a tawny owl with the vain
hope.
Is
that what that sound is?
Yeah. My bedroom window's just out there.
I wondered what that was.
Flock of tawny owls to swoop in and do a bit of predation, you know. I got a pole. I've just been onto an internet auction site and I bought myself a polecat suit. It's quite sort of, I'm going to dress up as a polecat, really slim and, you know, nimble. And I'm going to scuttle.
Did you just describe yourself as nimble?
No, I will be when I've done a bit of training and squeezed into the polecat suit. I got it in medium. So I'll have to squeeze into the polecat suit and start scurrying around the loft in the night. There's a thought for you.
Oh, gosh. See what I have to live
It's gone all Vic Leaves and Bob Mortimer, hasn't it?
Anyway, really? Okay. Shall we move on? So what's coming up next week? We are having a special part two next week, Friday at 9 a.m, the same time. So we will be back then and we'll be joined by some special guests as well. Of course, Lucy Lapwing will be joining us. Lucy's fantastic. Earlier on South Isolating Bird Club, she came to teach us a little bit about birdsong. She's a fantastic educator. I learn something new from Lucy every time she comes on. And of course, Gillian Burke will be joining us too.
Talking about Blackbirders Week.
Blackbirders Week, which has been really prominent and important.
Which has been great. We were doing Spring Watch whilst that was on, but we really keen keen to talk about that and promote the work that's been doing and the great successes that it had. Andy Rouse will be back, another one of our photographers, great photographer. Yeah. And he's been photographing pied and yellow wagtails. He's been doing some damselflies and also kingfishers, I note, this week. Mm. And you can find Andy's work, of course, on Instagram and Twitter. And he's running his own webinars and all sorts of things like that. So yeah. If you're a keen photographer, check out Andy's stuff. But he'll be back with us next week. And maybe Luke Massey. Luke Massey is out looking for bears.
Maybe. We can't promise. You know, wildlife is difficult. Never does what you want it to do. You could be sat waiting for hours and, you know, you might just... Yeah. You start seeing mirages of these animals appear.
Puts things in perspective, though.
It does. It really does. Hopefully Luke will be successful and he'll go out and be able to get some footage of bears.
No, I didn't mean that. I mean, Luke's out looking for bears and we're sat here moaning about mice. Imagine if we had brown bears in the loft.
I love a brown bear. Maybe not in the loft. You know, husbandry and wildlife.
Imagine the poodles barking at the bears. They go berserk at the foxes every night.
I'm not sure the poodles will be around for much longer.
We'd love to have bears. We'd love bears. We'd have to manage our poodles a bit differently.
We'd have to manage starlings.
What was that? Starlings coming into the feeder. They're emptying the feeder in two days at the moment.
And the feeder is a big feeder. We're feeding all of Hampshire, honestly. We really are.
Look at them all streaming in here. Look at them all now. Oh, all those young goldfinches and greenfinches. Look at them flying straight into my wallet, pulling out £20 notes, dropping them on the ground like they do. No, I'm not joking. Look, honestly.
Anyway, with that, there is only one thing we are going to be leaving you with, the ultimate poodle slow-mo. So for us, for now, for this week, we thank you so much for keeping with us and we hope you enjoyed our first special. We'll be back next week.
I'm sorry, No, I understand, Legal action. Okay, I'll pass it on. Oh, sorry, that was the Association of Film Score Writers and they've made an official complaint about your impersonation of the Jaws theme. They said it was the worst that they've ever heard and they are taking legal action because you've defamed the quality of that particular piece of music.
To be fair, creative license by everyone.